فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
ووصى معادا يستعين إلهه على ذكره وشكر بالحس على شك على ذكره وشكر وشكر بالحسن يعبد.
He counseled Mu'adh to seek assistance from Allah in establishing his dhikr, being grateful and perfecting his worship.
Also, the other benefit that the remembrance of Allah has is that our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he advised who? Hibbahu, the one he loved. Mu'adh ibn Jabal, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He advised him to ask his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to request from him, to do what for him? Al-awnu bi-dhikri, that Allah gives him the ability to remember him. And also that Allah gives him the ability to show gratitude to him. And that Allah also gives him the ability to perfect his ibadah. And that is, that which is asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the ability to remember him and to show him gratitude and also to perfect your ibadah. For him to give you the ability in all of those three, it is from أعظم المطالب, one of the greatest things to request from Allah. وأجلها, and it is also from the greatest thing that a person can gain, which is three things: الذكر والشكر وحسن العبادة. ثبت في سنن أبي داود, it has been authentically transmitted in سنن أبي داود. ومسند الإمام أحمد, and Imam Ahmad narrated it also in his Musnad. أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, that the Prophet said, يا معاذ, أو معاذ, والله إني لأحبك, معاذ, I love you. والله إني لأحبك, I love you. And a sign of a person who loves you is that they guide you to that which is good. And they tell you what will bring you greatness, prosperity and success في الدنيا والآخرة. That's a sign of a mushfiq, a nasih, a muhib, one who loves. So the messenger said to Mu'adh, Wallahi inni la'uhibbuk. Wallahi, I love you. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala destroy the rafidah, qabbahahumullah. A companion like Mu'adh, who the Prophet said to him, Wallahi inni la'uhibbuk. The Prophet didn't just say, I love you. He said to him, Wallahi, by Allah, inni la'uhibbuk, I love you. They want to insult and they want to ridicule a noble companion like that and take him out of the fold of Islam, trying to say that the Prophet loved the disbeliever and swore by Allah by saying that he loves the disbeliever. The Prophet said, Wallahi, inni la'uhibbuk. Did he say it once? No. The Prophet said, Wallahi, inni la'uhibbuk, again to Mu'adh, I love you. Wallahi, I love you, Mu'adh. And then after that, he said to him, Usika ya Mu'adh. Mu'adh, I advise you. La tada'anna, do not leave off. Fi duburi kulli salatin, after every prayer to say, Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika. Oh Allah, give me the ability in your remembrance. Wa shukrika, your gratitude. وحسن عبادتك, and also give me the ability to perfect my ibadah for you. He specified three things: al-dhikr, wa-shukr, وحسن عبادة. And that shows you على أنها أفضل ما يطلب العبد من الله العون عليه. It is from the greatest thing that a slave asks Allah for help. And that also teaches us a lesson, which is we are never able to do anything. We have no hila and we have no quwwa. We have no strength and we have no ability. If we fast, and then awnu min Allah, it's because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has given us the ability and He's allowed us to. If we pray, it's because of Him and what is very powerful and amazing is that he gives us the ability and gives us the strength for all of that, and then he rewards us on it. He rewards us for coming with fasting, for coming with praying, for coming with zakat, all of that, but it was all from him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we were able to do it in the first place. And when a person thinks about that and really analyzes that, he realizes how his Lord is very merciful to him and how he is deficient in showing gratitude to Allah, and how short he is in remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma a'inna ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husn ibadatik. Oh Allah, give us the ability to remember you, to show you gratitude, and to be able to perfect our ibadah. And that is why Allah told us in Surah Al-Fatiha that we say, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'een. You, O Allah, alone we worship, and only from you we seek help. Because we won't have any ability to do ibadah unless Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gives us isti'ana. And isti'ana itself is a ibadah. Allah chose to take it out of ibadah. Stand it separate from ibadah, shoulder to shoulder, to show you the seriousness and the importance of asking Allah for help. ولذلك, many people say to you, I want to seek knowledge, I want to learn, I want to be a scholar, I want depression to go, I want to remember Allah, I wanna. But the first thing that we need to ask ourselves is, have we asked Allah for help? When you were embarking on seeking knowledge, have you asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you awn, sa'ada, and ta'eed and tawfiq, the ability to do this, and the strength? But in fact, some of the salaf, rahimahumullah, it was narrated from, I think, Makhul and others, that they used to leave every single day their houses and they would say to Allah, we ask of you, we request from you, O Allah, the ability to achieve what we're looking for today. That which pleases you, O Allah. And they would leave their house doing that daily. And if we did do that, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala would have opened for us and given us all the good that we're looking for, and he would have protected from us all of the harms that we wish it not to come our way. نعم.
وأوصى لشخص قد أتى لنصيحة وقد كان في حمل الشرائع يجحد.
يجحد. Don't say يجحد. That's stubbornness. يجحد.
Huh.
There's no lamb there. Is there lamb there for you? So قد كان في حمل الشرائع يجحد.
وقد كان في حمل الشرائع يجحد.
Yeah, I just want the hat to come on, because if it comes يجحد, it becomes stubborn. Carry on the next line.
بأن لا يزرب رطبا لسانك هذه تعين على كل الأمور وتسعد.
And he counseled the man who approached him for advice, having found difficulty in fulfilling all religious ordinances, to let your tongue remain moist, for this will assist in all you face and bring you happiness.
The author, Sheikh Abdulrahman Nasir Saudi, rahimahullah, he goes on to mentioning another great, powerful benefit of a dhikr. And that is, when a man came to visit the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the author here is trying to point out in these two lines that a man came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Hadith Abdullah ibn Busr, he narrated it, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and it's found in Tirmidhi ibn Majah. And the wording here is the wording of a Tirmidhi. Al-Sheikh al-Albani graded this hadith to be sahih. And a rajulan qala ya Rasulullah, a man came to the Messenger. And he said to the Messenger, inna shara'i' al-Islam qad kathurat alayya, that the legal jurisprudence have become too much on me. Meaning the ahkam, for me to know them, has become too much on me. فَأَخْبِرْنِي بِشَيْءٍ أَتَشَبَّثُ بِهِ, tell me of something which I can hold on to strongly. Because the word أَتَشَبَّثُ means أي أتمسك به, I can hold on to. قال, the Prophet said, لا يزال, أما لا يزال لسانك رطبا من ذكر الله. Let your tongue remain consistent and moist in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many people have misunderstood this hadith, especially people of the tasawwuf and whatnot. So let's look at first the questioner, what he asked the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He said to him, إِنَّ شَرَائِعَ الْإِسْلَامِ قَدْ كَثُرَتْ عَلَيَّ, that the legal jurisprudence of the religion has become too much onto me. Is this man in any way, form or shape asking for the Prophet to uplift any of the jurisprudence rulings of him? Is he trying to say to the Prophet, I can't do it, leave me, I don't want to do it? Is that what he's asking for? Or is it that he wants the Prophet ﷺ to inform him and to tell him something that if he does, it will make it easy for him to come with the jurisprudent rulings that he found heavy? It's the second. So the man came to the Prophet on that concern. And what did the Prophet ﷺ advise him? That's why the author says, وَأَوْصَى لِشَخْصٍ قَدْ أَتَى لِنَصِيحَةٍ, a man who came on the grounds of advice. The messenger advised him and he said to him, وَقَدْ كَانَ فِي حَمْلِ الشَّرَائِعِ يَجْهَدُ, and this individual was striving hard in carrying the legislation and trying to implement everything. The Prophet advised him to do what? بِأَلَّا يَزَلْ رَطْبًا لِسَانُكَ هَذِهِ تُعِينُ عَلَى كُلِّ الْأُمُورِ وَتُسْعِدُهُ, that your tongue is consistent and it is also moist in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look what the author says, تُعِينُ عَلَى كُلِّ الْأُمُورِ وَتُسْعِدُهُ. Sayyidi trying to teach us this point, which is تُعِينُ, it will help you, عَلَى كُلِّ الْأُمُورِ, in all matters. وتسعد, the remembrance of Allah makes matters easy. وتسعد means that you're going to gain the doors of happiness, طمأنينة, الراحة, and سعادة, happiness and tranquility, and that's what we already spoke about. So the author, so the companion who came to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was instructed by remembering Allah, matters will become easy for you. فعل الأوامر وترك النواهي, doing as you are commanded to do and to stay away from that which you are prohibited from, it will become easy for you if you come with the remembrance of Allah. So when somebody says to you, the religion is becoming hard, I am finding it hard to wear the hijab, I am finding it hard to fast, I am finding it hard to pray Fajr, we say to them, بِأَلَّا يَزَلْ رَطْبًا لِسَانُكَ هَذِهِ, do not let your tongue dry, and don't make it one that becomes dry from the remembrance of Allah. Make it moist, consistently in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know why? The remembrance of Allah is actually what gives makes a person enthusiastic and energetic. Anyone who has woken up in the morning, has read his Quran, has done his adhkar al-sabah, goes out, he can take on the world. How energetic and enthusiastic is. But when you leave your house and you haven't remembered Allah and you haven't read your Quran and you haven't done your adhkar, and you leave, wallahi, the world feels heavy. You can't move a leg. You feel distressed. You feel like you don't want to get out of bed. And all of that is because of your heart. What we need to truly understand, and I always say this, is that you see a person who's very big, spends hours in the gym, physically big, and this individual lifts 100 kg, for example, or 50, 60, 70, some of them even bigger than that. The bar, the metal bar bends from the side. How heavy the weights that he's picking, you see? Two people have to help him. One on this side, on his right, on his left, and one on his right, have to both help him pick up this bar and do it. And he does it, he bench presses it. That same person may be unable to lift the duvet off themselves to go to Salatul Fajr and to pray it. What happened to that physical ability? Where did it go? The issue is not your arms and how big they are. It's not your legs and how strong they are and how powerful they are. Look at the weights that he picks up with his leg. Why can't he walk? Why is he finding it hard to do wudu? Look at it, pay attention. The water that he places on his face at Fajr to do wudu with is not harder than the burning that you're doing when you're going to the gym. The water's easier. The issue is the heart. The heart is dead or it's ill, so the person won't be able to. So that's why the author here is saying, تُعِينُ عَلَى كُلِّ الْأُمُورِ وَتُسْعِدُ. And I can personally say that when we were young, and my father, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala bestow his never-ending mercy onto him, when we memorized the Qur'an, we found the secular knowledge so easy. It made matters very easy for us. The hifz of the Qur'an, going into hifz and memorization and learning, even studying some of the most complicated things that when I was young I used to find hard, it became easy after I embarked on memorizing the Quran. And it's seen that a lot of the times the huffaz are the best in school. You see? So the dhikr, being with you consistently, is what helps you. It helps you on what? It helps you in doing other acts of obedience that you may find hard. وذلك our messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, he would find, call out Bilal, and what would he say to Bilal? يا بلال أرحنا بالصلاة, because the salah consists of dhikr, ibadat, being us, أرحنا بالصلاة, come on, do the adhan for us. This is going to bring us tranquility. طمأنينة, صح? It's sad that shaitan has fooled and duped many of us to when we become depressed and we feel down. Instead of going for dhikr, he makes us go more into sins. Listen to music. Yeah, instead of running to the Quran and doing dhikr, the person goes and goes to listening to the voice of shaitan. Because Allah says in the Quran, وَاسْتَفْزِزْ مَنِ اسْتَطَعْتَ مِنْهُمْ بِصَوْتِكَ وَأَجْلِبْ عَلَيْهِمْ بِخَيْلِكَ وَرَجْلِكَ وَشَارِكُمْ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ وَعِدْهُمْ وَمَا يَعِدْهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. The scholars, they said this verse means that this is the voice of shaitan. So when you're listening to music, you're listening to the shaitan himself. And remember, can shaitan and dhikr be in the same? No. Because before, what did we take? That the dhikr, what does it do? It repels shaitan and it gets out rid of shaitan. But he will make sure that you don't do dhikr and that you listen to music. But you're in a state of depression. You're already feeling down. He'll push you even more. He'll push you even more into music. Go out clubbing, drink, fornicate. Your heart was at probably, let's say, you were at a state where your heart was ill. He wants to make your heart dead. Move you from the stage of illness. Because we said that the hearts are three types, aren't they? Marad, which is, sorry, a heart which is hay, hay qalb, which is salim, which is the one that's going to benefit the day of judgment. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Qalb, which is salim. The second one is qalb, which is marid, ill. The ill heart is the heart of the believer. Sometimes he goes to do the righteous actions and he remembers Allah and he cries, and then sometimes shaitan grabs him again and he's caught up in sins and haram and whatnot. You're at that stage, مثلا. and you're becoming depressed because sins are you're being burdened with sins and you're doing sins. Instead of coming to Allah and working towards the remembrance of Allah, Shaytan will come and he will pull you away to the third stage, which is the worst, which is qalb, which is mayyit, dead. A dead person, what can he hear? Yeah? What they say? وَمَالِ مَيِّتٍ إِلَامُ. The dead person has no pain, right? You can poke him all day, you can slap him, he's dead. This is what happened to this person. Pain and everything has just become numb now. And that's what he wants to take you to. Naam.
وأخبر أن الذكر غرس لأهله بجنات عدن والمساكن تمهد.
He mentioned further that dhikr is planted for those who engage in it, in the gardens of Aden, and their dwellings are prepared.
The author now also mentioned another benefit of dhikr. All of these are benefits of dhikr, which is أنه غراس الجنة. The plants of Jannah is through your remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every time you remember Allah and you do a dhikr, what happens? A plant is seeded. A seed is planted in Jannah for you. And that is based on the hadith al-Imam al-Tirmidhi narrated. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, لَقِيْتُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ لَيْلَةَ أُسْرِيَ بِي فَقَالَ يَا مُحَمَّدْ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I met Nabiullah Ibrahim the night in which I was ascended up. فَقَالَ, he said to me, يَا مُحَمَّدْ أَقْرِ أُمَّتَكَ مِنِّي السَّلَامْ. Nabiullah Ibrahim said, convey my greetings to your people. وَأَخْبِرْهُمْ, and tell them, أَنَّ الْجَنَّةَ طَيِّبَةُ التُّرْبَةِ. The Jannah, Allahu Akbar, how the prophets want Jannah for the people. And this is the reality, Ibrahim, this is not his people. But he wants Nabiullah Muhammad's people to enter Jannah. The righteous people always want good for people. And they want khair for the people. And they want Jannah for people. They don't want people's destruction. They don't like people's calamity and agony. Jannah for everybody. That's where they want everybody to go. So he told him, say to them, أن الجنة طيبة التربة, that the earth, or the earth of Jannah, if I could say that, is طيبة. I mean, it's a land that takes in, if it gets planted the seed, it will produce. عذبة الماء, the water, it's nice. It's not bitter or salty water. وأنها قيعان, and it's earth that produces things. So the sand is good. Also, it produces good. وأن غراسها سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. And the plants that are placed in Jannah are سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. Those adhkar is the plants that are going to be placed. So every single time a slave is excessive in the remembrance of Allah, then when you go to Jannah, your gardens are going to be very green. It's going to look beautiful. You don't have to do a lot of hard work. You don't have to scream. You don't have to run around, plant it, place water in it. You don't have to, none of that. Just by sitting down and saying, Subhanallah, Walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. By saying that unrestrictedly and going on, you are placing in your Jannah plants. Wa akhbara, and the Prophet also told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, anna dhikra gharsul li ahlihi bi jannati adnin. Every time that the person increases in the remembrance of Allah, it's a plant that's increased in his Jannah. بجنات عدن. جنات عدن is what? It's جنة الخلد. It's the Jannah of eternity. والمساكين تمهدوا. Also, houses and place of residency is prepared. stations are also prepared for them. Because this person is moving from one house to another house, so he has to be to keep up with him. And for every, his house is getting renovated for him. He's sitting with you, work is going off for him. It's a place لا عين رأت, eyes have not seen, ولا أذن سمعت, ears have never heard of the likes of this place that you're getting. ولا خطر على قلب بشر, and he has never come to the heart of any true believer or any human being whatsoever. That which Allah is putting forward for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, just by your tongue moving. Everybody who remembers Allah and comes with obedience and worship, then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala through that is preparing for them houses and place of residence. Naam.
وأخبر أن الله يذكر عبده ومعه على كل الأمور يسدد.
He also stated that Allah makes mention of his servant and is with him in all affairs, setting them aright.
The author now mentions an extra two benefits of a dhikr. He says, وَأَخْبَرَ أَنَّ, the first one this is, okay? وَأَخْبَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَذْكُرُ عَبْدَهُ. The first benefit here, from all the benefits that we've already mentioned, the first one in this line of poetry is, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the Lord of the heavens and the earth, the one who created you and the one who sustains you, is remembering you. فَاذْكُرُونِ أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Remember me, so I will remember you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, a hadith which is collected by Bukhari and Muslim, is in Sahihain, min hadith Abi Huraira, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, that he said, يقول الله تعالى, Allah says, فإن ذكرني في نفسه, if the slave remembers me in himself, he remembers me, ذكرته في نفسي, I also remember him, Allah is saying this. So if he remembers me by himself, Allah will remember you alone. وإن ذكرني في ملأٍ, and if he remembers me in a gathering, Allah says, ذكرته في ملأٍ خير منهم, I am going to remember him in a gathering better than the gathering which he remembered me. Wallahi is enough for a person. وَكَفَى بِالذَّاكِرِ شَرَفًا. Enough honor for you as a person who's remembering Allah is, and enough for you honor and virtue is, أَنْ يَذْكُرَهُ رَبُّهُ, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the Lord of the heavens and the earth, to remember you. There's no honor greater than that. Today, if you were informed that a leader or somebody spoke about you, or your name came up in a gathering of righteous people or in a gathering of highly respected people, they brought up your name, you'll get so happy. You'll feel so excited and so amazed. You'll be baffled, mashallah, taken back. Because your name was just mentioned. By who, lakin? By normal human beings like you. فَمَا بَالُكَ, what do you think if Allah is the one who remembers you? And he doesn't just remember you. He remembers you in the gathering of his angels. And he says, oh my angels, do you see my slave over there, Fulan ibn Fulan? Do you see him? Naam. Look what he's doing. He's remembering me. And your mention, your name comes up in the discussion between Allah and his angels. That is sharaf, that is an honor enough for you. That is a virtue that one would give everything to gain. But Allah has given it to us for a very simple thing, which is to remember him by saying, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Words that are very light on the tongue gives us something very high. But the issue here right now is, we don't know the value, and we don't yet feel the value of Allah remembering us. Allah remembering us with his angels in his gathering. We still haven't felt that. But we have somehow felt that if a leader today was to remember us, or a group of respected scholars were to mention our name and bring it up in a gathering. Today, if you look at the biography of scholars who would you see that praises them? Other scholars, right? And the praise of the other scholars gives this person what? A very high status. If other scholars reference them, then you think to yourself, Allahu Akbar. The matter is greater when Allah is the one doing that. فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ Remember me, I will remember you. That itself I said, كَفَى بِالذَّاكِرِ شَرَفًا وَفَضْلًا That is enough virtue for you. That is enough nobility for you as an individual. Then the author mentions the second, which is, وَمَعَهُ عَلَى كُلِّ الْأُمُورِ يُسَدِّدُ The second virtue that he mentions here is Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is the one who keeps you upright in all of your affairs. Allah is going to make sure that you as an individual don't deviate, don't curve, that you stay steadfast and upright. Allah makes sure that He helps you and He aids you and supports you. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam al-Bukhari narrated mu'allaqan. Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Al-Imam Ahmad narrated it in his musnad mawsoolan, connected. And others have also brought it mawsoolan, connected. So the hadith is connected and it's authentic. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى Allah said, أَنَا مَعَ عَبْدِي مَا ذَكَرَنِي I am with my slave whilst he remembers me. وَتَحَرَّكَتْ بِي شَفَتَاهُ And his tongue moves, and his lips move, I am with him. As long as my slave remembers me and his lips are moving in remembrance of me, I am with him. This word that's used in the hadith is very powerful. Ana ma'a abdi, I am with my slave. This is ma'iyatun khasa. This is a specific type of ma'iyah. It's the type which means I am going to keep him upright. I'm going to protect him. I'm going to give him the ability of coming with righteous deeds and greatness. I'm going to protect him from any hardship and pain. Ibn al-Qayyim said in his kitab Al-Wabil al-Sayyib, Hiya ma'iyatun bil-qurb. It is the ma'iyya meaning Allah is close to you. Wal-wilaya, Allah has taken you as an ally. Wal-mahabbati wal-nusr. It is the ma'iyya that Allah is going to give you victory and He loves you. Wal-tawfiq, and that Allah is going to give you the ability. And he said it's like the statement of Allah, Inna Allaha ma'al ladina taqaw. Allah is with those who are pious. And it's like the statement of Allah, Wallahu ma'as sabirin, Allah is with those who are patient. And it's also like the verse of Allah, Wa inna Allaha la ma'al muhsinin. Allah is with those who come with excellency. La tahzan, inna Allaha ma'ana. It's also like the statement of Allah, Don't be sad, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is with you. Ibn Qayyim carries on saying, وَلِذَّاكِرِ مِنْ هَذِهِ الْمَعِيَّةِ نَصِيبٌ وَافِرٌ كَمَا فِي الْحَدِيثِ الْإِلَهِ And he said, that same ma'iyyah, ma'iyyatu al-qurbi wal-wilayati wal-mahabbati wal-nusrati wal-tawfiq, that ma'iyyah, also the dhakir, just like the muttaqi, because in Allah ma'a alladhina attaqaw, the taqi has a ma'iyyah. That's, which ma'iyyah is it? Ma'iyyatu al-qurbi wal-wilayati wal-nusri wal-mahabbati wal-tawfiq, sah? The taqi has that, right? And also the ma'asabiri, the sabir has it, the patient one. And also the muhsin has it. All of them who have it, Ibn al-Qayyim says, وَلِذَّاكِرِ مِنْ هَذِهِ الْمَعِيَّةِ نَصِيبٌ وَافِرٌ The one who remembers Allah has a great portion of it. And then he brings the hadith, أَنَا مَعَ عَبْدِي مَا ذَكَرَنِي وَتَحَرَّكَتْ بِي شَفَتَهُ I am with my slave. As long as he remembers me and his tongue and his lips are moving in my remembrance. Ibn al-Qayyim carries on saying after a while, وَالْمَعِيَّةُ الْحَاصِلَةُ لِلذَّاكِرِ مَعِيَّةِ The ma'iyyah that is for the one who remembers Allah, لَا يُشْبِهُهَا شَيْءٍ Nothing is like it, nothing is equal to it. وَهِيَ أَخَصُّ مِنَ الْمَعِيَّةِ Rather, it is even more specific than the ma'iyyah. الْحَاصِلَةُ لِلْمُحْسِنِ وَالْمُتَّقِي That is for the one who has taqwa and the one who has ihsan, who comes with ihsan. The dhakir is more, he said, Ibn al-Qayyim. وَهِيَ مَعِيَّةٌ because it's a مَعِيَّةٌ لَا تُدْرِكُهَا الْعِبَارَةُ وَلَا تَنَالُهَا صِفَةٌ وَلَا تَعَلُّقَ وَلَا تُعْلَمُ بِالذَّوْقِ because it's the مَعِيَّةٌ that cannot be understood by any wordings that a person puts forward. And it can't be gained with any characteristics. And it can't be known through taste. And he's right, because these ones who are the muhsin and the taqi, they are dhakir, they're remembering Allah already. Ihsan is a remembrance of Allah. The muhsin is one who remembered Allah. So why does dhikr have a ma'iyya when already ihsan and taqwa is already a form of remembrance of Allah? It's because there's an extra. It's an extra station. Greater than the sabir, than the muhsin, than the taqi. And that has been, those two characteristics have been all gathered in the hadith as Shaykhani, Bukhari and Muslim both narrated in the Sahih al-Hadith Abi Huraira. أنا عند ظني عبدي بي وأنا معه إذا ذكرني فإن ذكرني في نفسي ذكرت في نفسي وإن ذكرني في ملأ ذكرت في ملأ خير منهم. Those two which the author is mentioning, those two that he just mentioned, which is what was the first one, that Allah will remember you and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will mention you as long as you're mentioning him and you're remembering him. That was the first, right? And the second one was what? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to make your matters upright for you and keep you steadfast. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to give you victory. And Allah is going to aid you and support you, right? Both of those are found in this hadith. Where is it found? The first one is that, أنا عند ظني عبدي بي. I am what my slave thinks of me. وَأَنَا مَعَهُ إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي. And I am with him if he remembers me. That's the second one. The first one of the virtues that the author mentioned, which is فَإِنْ ذَكَرَنِي فِي نَفْسِي ذَكَرْتُ فِي نَفْسِي وَإِنْ ذَكَرَنِي فِي مَلَئٍ ذَكَرْتُ فِي مَلَئٍ خَيْرٍ مِّنْهُمْ is there. نعم.